and welcome once again to Treasures of Our Faith. I'm Celia Regis in the company of my spiritual brother, Keith Patrick, who will be proclaiming the Word of God to us as usual. And we're both very humbly in the company and supporting our spiritual director, Father John Theodore. I invite you to stay with us for the next hour or so as Father John Theodore helps us to discover the glory of the cross. You know, young people these days are wearing the cross as a fashion item. Are they really aware of the significance and power of this sign? Well, Father John T. reveals the beauty of this treasure. Father John T.
We begin with a quotation from St. Paul, Galatians 6:14.
But far be it from me to glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world.
Paul says, I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was so amazed by and grateful for the death of Jesus on the cross that he could not contain himself. A thing of shame had become for Paul the symbol of the highest glory. The cross is in many ways the central point of our Christian life. Paul saw it as the most important part of his faith. Boasting in the cross means taking pride in it, finding in it the reason for joy and fulfillment, and placing great value on it. Paul was boasting in the cross and refusing to boast in his own ability. It meant placing our own achievement on a lower secondary level. The event of Jesus' death on the cross saved us from eternal death and brought us everlasting life. Paul could have gloried and boasted in a number of things, but he saw the cross as far greater than anything he could accomplish. The cross means we are sinners who cannot save ourselves. Without the cross, there would be no resurrection. Without the cross, there would be no salvation. Without the cross, there would be no hope for eternal life. The cross is a real paradox. His death brought us life. His crown of thorns became our crown of glory. His pierced heart has given us a new heart. His abject humiliation has brought us our dignity. To the unbelieving eye, the cross is nothing more than a foolish exercise in suffering. But to those who believe, the cross is the instrument of salvation, nothing less than the power of God for our salvation. 1 Corinthians 1:18.
For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
Facing the cross, we see two important things. Firstly, our God is a God who does not want to be separated from his children. Secondly, we see that sin is not something trivial that could be overcome with a minor remedy, but required nothing less than the death of the Son of God. In this sense, the cross was at the center of God's plan for humanity. Jesus knew that he had to embrace the cross because nothing else was sufficient to wipe away sin and disarm the enemy. To face our Christian life, we must face the fact that Jesus had to die for our sakes. 1 Peter 2:24.
He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed.
By his death on the cross, Jesus set us free from our disobedience, our pride, our anger, our self-centeredness. His death on the cross brought us victory over every one of our sins. It is not easy to embrace the reality of the cross. When Peter heard Jesus speak about the cross, he objected. Matthew 16:21-23.
From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid, Lord, this shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not on the side of God, but of men.
Peter was objecting. But we must embrace the reality of the cross if we call ourselves Christian. There are two realities in the cross. First, Jesus died once for all. But secondly, the cross must be applied to our lives. We experience the grace of the cross only when we take hold of it and apply its power to our lives. There's no victory here if we knowingly allow sin to rule our lives. We make the cross a stumbling block when we think and act in ways that encourage sin, when we know what we are doing and take no steps to stop the sin. It is one thing to sin and repent, knowing that we have done something wrong. It's quite another thing to let a pattern of sin have full reign in our lives, knowing that we are bringing pain to the Lord. We live in a world that condones lying, manipulation, and deception. A world that approves of abortion, same-sex marriage, and living out of wedlock. According to our world, there's nothing wrong with extreme self-centeredness as long as it doesn't hurt anybody. This thinking is opposed to the message of the cross. The cross says, lay down your life and serve God and his people. Matthew 16:25-26.
For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life?
Jesus' victory is our victory. His resurrection is our resurrection. His triumph over sin and death is our triumph over sin and death. So we bring honor to Jesus by meditating on the cross very frequently. We tell him we are sinners and we are grateful for the price he paid. We must look to the power of the cross to set us free from those raging sin patterns that hurt us. We glory in the cross when we acknowledge the victory that Jesus won for us. When Jesus speaks of taking up our cross, we must know what he is saying. Our suffering could be physical, spiritual, or psychological. It could come from cancer. It could come from the inner wound caused by someone persecuting us because of our faith. It could come in the form of a stillborn child or in the form of a healthy child not doing well at school. Whatever its source, we all have situations that we could honestly call our crosses. Jesus healed many people who had terrible diseases, so we could ask Jesus to take away our burdens to heal us. He removed their crosses because of his love. He could also remove our crosses. He loves to heal us. The deep mystery of suffering is that while God heals some people do not get healed. Saint Bernadette was at the beginning of the story of healing at Lourdes. She never got healed. There are some who hardly have any faith and they are healed. Some are healed after praying a simple prayer. Some pray for years and never get healed. This is the mystery of suffering. This is the mystery of the cross. Paul had a thorn in his flesh that he prayed about, and Jesus said no. In fact, Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane prayed to the Father to be set from the pain of the cross. The Father said no. This is the mystery of the cross. We must never be afraid or ashamed to pray for healing for ourselves, our children, for our friends. God might heal some of us. He might not heal all. He has his reasons of love for healing us and for not healing us. Jesus spent a big chunk of his life just healing people. Jesus said that one of the signs that we were Christians is that we would lay hands on the sick and see them get healed. Mark 16, 17 to 18.
And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover.
So healing is part of Christian life. We pray for healing and God might heal us this time and not another time. When he does not heal us, we ask for the grace we need to carry our cross of suffering. We can carry our cross merely as a good person or as an empowered person. A good person accepts the cross without complaining, but it is normally in our own strength. The empowered person faces his cross differently. God wants to give us his own divine grace to help us carry our crosses. Jesus told Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you." In view of this help from God, Paul could say these words, 2 Corinthians 12:9-10.
But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. I will all the more gladly boast of my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong."
Embracing our cross with the help of God's grace is different from just being a good person trying our best. The person depending on God's grace finds resources of strength, trust, and surrender that we know are not our own, but coming from a loving, merciful God. People like this discover that they have much compassion for other people's suffering. The cross can become an opportunity for us to grow closer to Jesus and give him more glory. Throughout his life, our last Pope, John Paul II, taught us that suffering could unite us with Jesus. He wrote an apostolic letter on suffering, teaching us about bearing our crosses with the help of God's grace. If we face a heavy cross, we could ask for help to be relieved of it. There's nothing wrong with this. But if the cross remains, we ask Jesus for his help to embrace it. Suffering is an evil and will not be part of the new reality when Jesus comes again. God is able to bring good out of any evil. He can teach us how to embrace suffering in a way that draws us closer to Jesus. We must pray for those carrying heavy crosses and ask Jesus for his abundant grace to help them and to bring them to his peace. Faith is not simply a matter of human effort, striving to do the right things and to believe the right things. The Christian life is about the power of God alive in us and in our world. It's about God filling us with his power to overcome sin and live in his love. The cross is one of our greatest spiritual weapons because it opens the door to the grace we need to live the Christian life. St. Paul is clear on this. 2 Corinthians 10, 4-5.
For the weapons of our warfare are not worldly, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ.
Human striving, while it is a good thing, does not open itself to God's spiritual weapons. These weapons from God are stronger than any temptation of Satan. Paul tells us that they're strong enough to break down strongholds of sin that have made their home in us. We may have allowed anger or lust to establish a stronghold in our lives. The stronghold can be destroyed by taking hold of a weapon like the cross. It is a cross that gives God's power to defend the arguments of temptation that come into our mind. It is a cross that helps us to say no to sins, deceitful and empty promises of joy. The scripture tells us that blood and water flowed from the side of Christ when he died on the cross. The church has always taught that blood is a symbol of the cross and water a symbol of the Holy Spirit. The church teaches us that if you want to know God better, overcome sin, and serve the church, we need both the cross and the Spirit. In the letter to the Galatians, Paul is very clear about the relationship between the cross and the Spirit. When he saw how the Galatians had lost the spiritual clarity they once had, he became very passionate. Galatians 3:1-2.
O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified? Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith?
Paul told the Galatians that the cross of Jesus Christ gave them the full rights of sons and daughters. They were no longer slaves to sin, but co-heirs with Christ. He warned them that they were not experiencing the freedom that Jesus won for them on the cross unless they asked the Spirit to show them how to be free. He was firm with them. Galatians 5, 24 to 25.
And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit.
In other words, we have to take up the power of the cross in our lives, but this can only be done by the power of the Holy Spirit. We have to learn how to apply the power of the cross in our lives. We must allow the cross to do its work in us, removing the strongholds of sin and replacing them with the fruit of the Spirit. We must believe in the power of the cross. We have to keep telling ourselves that Jesus died for our sins on the cross and that sin has no more power over us. Paul says it like it is in Romans 6:6.
We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the sinful body might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin.
The more we keep repeating these facts about the cross, the more we will see the power of the cross released in our lives. We keep on repeating these things about the cross and try our best to avoid sin. We'll get a new ability to say no to sin and temptation. The temptations that used to drag us down and the stronghold that enslaved us will lose their power until they become harmless. In a practical way, we must find areas in our lives where we have problems, and we could keep proclaiming St. Paul's words that we are dead to sin in those areas and alive to God. We try our best to surrender them to the cross where they can be put to death. Eventually, we will see more peace and freedom in our lives. In the power of the cross, we can conquer everything that separates us from Christ. Romans 8:38-39.
For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
We are convinced of freedom because we know the power of the cross has set us free from sin and temptation. All of us could know this power. The cross teaches us many lessons. It teaches us that Jesus overcame sin not by blasting it with his power or driving it out of his kingdom, but by taking it upon himself. He overcame evil with good, hatred with love, rebellion with obedience, violence with meekness, falsehood with truth. In the cross, he freed us forever. We must pass from seeing the cross as a sign of condemnation and curse to seeing the cross as salvation, pardon, our only hope. Many see the Father giving up Jesus on the cross as a sign of cruelty and rugged justice. They do not see it as a sign of the Father's love. The story of Abraham helps us to understand the Father and the cross. Genesis 2:16-18.
By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. And by your descendants shall all the nations of the earth bless themselves, because you have obeyed my voice.
We must exclaim the words of the exalted that we sing at Easter. Father, how wonderful your care for us. How boundless your merciful love. To ransom a slave, you gave away your son. That's the exalted we sing at Easter. So now we understand the words, God did not spare his only son. The father was making a supreme sacrifice by giving up his son. Our solitude in this world cannot be overcome except by faith in the Father's love. Reminding us that God did not spare his only son, Paul acclaims these words, Romans 8:31-37.
What then shall we say to this? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all things with him? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Is it Christ Jesus who died? Yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We are told in the scriptures, you were not given the spirit of slaves to fall back into fear, but the spirit of children to cry out, Abba, Father. When we ask Jesus, what could we do to show our love for this kind of love from the Father? Jesus will tell us, have confidence in him, trust him against everything, against everyone. When you are in darkness and distress, when difficulties bring you to suffocation and you are at the point of giving up, you pull yourself together and declare loudly, Father, I no longer understand, but I trust you. This will bring you to peace. Jesus suffered and died freely out of love, not by chance, not for necessity, but out of love. The gospel is nothing more than the good news of God's love in Jesus Christ. Not only the gospel, but the whole Bible is nothing other than the news of God's mysterious, incomprehensible love for people. The whole of Scripture shouts out, God loves you. This kind of love helps us to understand the words of Jesus on the cross. Father, forgive them. We must be ready to suffer and forgive. Jesus spoke these words on the cross and left them to us so that we could keep them alive throughout the centuries and arm ourselves with them. These words were not intended merely simply to forgive the enemies Jesus had at the time, but to forgive his enemies today, our enemies, the enemies of the church. The Christian is called upon to forgive those who cause suffering. Christianity is the religion of forgiving enemies. Let me say that again. Christianity is the religion of forgiving enemies. There are some among us today publicly forgive those who murdered members of their family. They are a beautiful witness for us. They show us that the cross is really possible today. Because of the cross, we could forgive enemies. In the story of the desert, when Moses made a bronze serpent and put it up on a pole, all who were stung by the snakes lived. Jesus told Nicodemus these words, John 3:13-14.
No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up.
So just as the brazen serpent was the only answer for the Israelites, so Jesus on the cross is the only solution for us. In the desert, they were stung by snakes. We have all been infected by the power of sin, and without a remedy, we are doomed. As strong as the venom is, it can be rendered powerless if we simply look to the cross where Jesus died for all our sins. The more time we spend looking at the cross, we'll experience the ability and desire to put behind us all the things that are opposed to the way God wants us to live. We'll find God's grace flowing from the cross, helping us to set free in ways we never thought possible. All this is possible because we discover the beauty of the cross. The power of the cross helps us to overcome everything that separates us from Jesus and from our brothers and sisters. When Adam tried to advance his own life independent of God, he brought death on us all. Jesus surrendered his life completely on the cross and so won life and salvation for us all. Jesus embraced the cross with a heart full of love for us and reverence for his Father. Paul boasted about the cross because it meant freedom. Freedom from the weight of sin. Freedom from the bondage and control that sin can have over us. Freedom to live as a child of God and member of the church. Paul had come to experience the freedom that Jesus died to give him, and the experience made him shout. He discovered that because of the cross, nothing could ever separate him from the love of God, and that discovery turned his life upside down. Paul reminds us that before Jesus died, we were estranged from God and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds. But God himself reconciled us through the cross of his Son. Now we can stand before the Father, holy and blameless, so that we remain steadfast in the faith. Colossians 1:21-23.
And you who once were estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel which you heard, which has been preached to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister.
So Paul says we remain steadfast in the faith, we don't budge. As Catholics, when we say we have this cross to bear, it means we are trying to endure some difficult event or situation without complaining, believing that we are growing closer to God as we walk the challenging path. But there's another cross that Jesus spoke about that is meant to be part of our everyday lives and not just in times of trouble or sorrow. The words of Jesus are clear. Luke 9:23.
And he said to all, if any man would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me.
Here, Jesus is not speaking about a cross as trial or suffering. He was talking about a cross of self-denial, a cross that is crucial to our call to holiness. This type of cross is not something that crops up at different points in our lives. It is a cross we are called to endure every day of our lives. This call to take up our cross every day is connected with the call to imitate Jesus in his dying and rising. Jesus made it clear to us, Luke 9:24.
For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake, he will save it.
When Jesus died on the cross, he put our sin to death. When he rose, he brought a new life for everyone who believes and is baptized in his name. In a similar way, Jesus wants us to lose our old life of sin so that we can find a new life that he won for us on the cross. We have a part to play here, but God's grace and power has the major part to play. Let me repeat that. We have a part to play here, but God's grace and power has the major part to play. When we pray, fast, and give alms, we are dying to ourselves in preparation for the resurrection. Jesus spoke of saving and losing many times in the scriptures. Mark 2:22.
And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh skins.
The old wineskin of a life bound by sin or unbelief cannot hold the new wine of life from Christ. Jesus simply cannot enter a mind that is fiercely opposed to him. In his letter to the Ephesians, Paul spoke about the old self and the new self. Ephesians 4:22.
Put off your old nature, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful lusts.
We rarely can become a new creature, a new creature. There is nothing in our lives that cannot be conquered through patience, faith, trust, and perseverance, and all these flow from the cross. The world is full of sadness, but God pours a unique blessing to help his people live the good life in the world and to convince the world that they could live his life. He gave the world Francis of Assisi, Teresa of Avila, and in our own days, Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Today, God is raising up ordinary people to bring the hope of the gospel to the world that does not want God. Jesus is inviting us to take up our cross and defeat in us that is opposed to him. He is offering us the power of his cross to help us with the battle against sin. All this does not happen overnight. We could start to focus on one aspect of the old self and ask Jesus to help us to have victory in this area. When we move in this way, God will run in to give us his help. Many of us know that our old life of sin was crucified with Christ, but we find ourselves returning to the same old sins. Sometimes a very simple prayer asking Jesus to set us free in the power of the cross is all we need. It doesn't have to be complicated. Jesus is waiting for us to turn to him, to trust in the power of his cross, and to ask for the grace to be set free. We have Paul's words again, Galatians 6:14.
But far be it from me to glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world.
Paul speaks of being crucified. Paul desires crucifixion with Christ, a crucifixion to sin, to indwelling sin, to sin in its every shape. He desired not only a crucifixion of one sin, but all sin. This is the meaning of fellowship with Christ in his suffering. There must be a crucifixion of the indwelling power of sin. Outward sin may be cut off and even honestly confessed and mourned over, while the root of the sin is overlooked and gains strength. The sacrament of reconciliation, confession, is important here. This sacrament is about more than being forgiven. It's about being restored and healed. It's a healing sacrament. It's about Jesus putting to death old sin and giving us new life and hope as well. In this sacrament, we're going to ask Jesus to take all our old sin to his cross, where they could be put to death once and for all. When we feel trapped in some unpardonable sin like abortion, we should not be afraid to turn to Jesus and seek the power of his cross to set us free. We must be convinced that he's able to conquer every sin that we could commit, even abortion. Some of us might be burdened with a sin like anger, the inability to control our temper. We have the word that Jesus said to Paul, 2 Corinthians 12:9.
But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. I will all the more gladly boast of my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me."
My grace is sufficient for you. It means that God's grace is more powerful than all the temptations of Satan and of the world. It might just strike you, God's grace can help me control my anger. Writing out a simple prayer asking Jesus to help you with your temper could be the beginning of victory. We must never be afraid to lay our situation at the foot of the cross. The cross of Jesus is the key to our freedom. Within that cross is the power to help us stop smoking, to help us stop losing our temper. The cross has the power to remove our guilt and our shame. When Jesus asks us to deny ourselves and take up our cross, he's asking us to turn away from sin and to follow him. But he's not expecting us to do it without his grace. We should wave the banner saying, "My grace is sufficient for you." We could do that. Never forget those words. "My grace is sufficient for you." Every time we see an image of the cross, you should be filled with thanksgiving and awe of the Lord. The scriptures tell us that some Greeks came to see Jesus. Upon hearing this, Jesus replied that the hour has come, and he headed for Jerusalem and for death. The Greeks represent all Gentiles, and Jesus is affirming that on the cross, he's dying for everybody, Jews and Gentiles. The stage was set for the universal Messiah to reveal his true self, his true glory. The cross has made a way by which all men can approach him with confidence, Jews and Gentiles. The shape of the cross is interesting. It touches earth, but it points to heaven. The arms of the cross are outstretched to all the world. Whoever wishes may come for salvation. After the Greeks had come, Jesus said, "When I am lifted up, I will draw everyone to myself." The cross was salvation for everyone. We have here the cross in all of its shame, but most importantly, in all of its beauty. God wants to send a message of beauty and hope throughout life, through our union with Him, through our love for the beauty of the cross. As the cross reveals the Father's love, it also reveals the Father's judgment. The ruler of the world would be ejected, and everyone would be lifted up with Jesus on the cross. The image on the cross reveals the sort of God we believe in and one sort of response He expects of us. First, when Jesus freely gave Himself over to sinful men, He clearly showed the world that the Father was full of love. The Father was willing to go to any length to bring all of us into a love relationship with Himself. Second, the image of the cross invites us to love God in return. We have to love this kind of God. Thus, through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross, God offers Himself to all. And through the cross, we all can respond in kind. Love has a cost. It involves suffering and sacrifice. We as Christians follow Jesus to the cross, where He shows us the way to the Father. 1 Corinthians 1:18.
For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
There's a folly to the cross. That folly still exists today. The glory of the Christian is the cross. For the cross points to God's love far better than any other blessing received in life. Remember that. The glory of the Christian is the cross. For the cross points to God's love far better than any other blessing received in life. It's a universal sign of God's love and a universal invitation to follow Jesus. We should not be afraid to show others the love of God, even though His love leads to the cross. Paul speaks of boasting of the cross of Christ. Do we glory in the cross of Christ, or do we glory in our own works? Did we receive salvation through the cross of Christ, or through our own efforts, through gritting our teeth? The cross was an outstanding victory over Satan, death, and condemnation. As the people of God, every believer should live his or her daily life with an awareness of the cross of Christ. Paul points out the significance of the cross and the blood to the Colossians. Colossians 1:19-20.
For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross.
There's a sense in which we can never know Jesus without the cross. The penal aspect of the death of the Lord is of the essence of the gospel. 1 Peter 2:24.
He Himself bore our sins in His body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By His wounds you have been healed.
Isaiah, hundreds of years before, prophesied concerning the crucifixion of Jesus for the Son of Man. Isaiah 53:4-12.
Surely He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed Him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Upon Him was the chastisement that made us whole. And with His stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and He was afflicted, yet He opened not His mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is dumb, so He opened not His mouth. By oppression and judgment He was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief when he makes himself an offering for sin. He shall see his offspring, he shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the fruit of the travail of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
Isaiah, 100 years before, told us exactly what will happen on Calvary. Hundreds of years before. We would never know salvation from the penalty of sin were it not for the fact that Jesus died on the cross for us. Isaac Watts, in the year 1707, wrote these words: "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save the death of Christ, my Lord, and all the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood." You remember that? He said, "Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ, my Lord, and all the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood." May God bless you.
Thank you, Father John T., the glory of the cross. And I certainly saw myself there, you know, thinking that I could do this, you know, I have gumption, I have stamina, I could bear it out, when I am so fragile, I am nothing. What do you think, Keith?
Oh, just to hear those words, "my grace is sufficient for you," means that I don't have to work the way, in that same way you're talking about it. It means I could just surrender to the cross.
Yes. Yeah. Would that we would all humble ourselves and take that to heart. You know, certainly we're open in the few minutes we have left to take your questions and or your comments. You know, and you know, I'm talking about but humbling yourself, offering yourself up, just placing yourself onto us before the cross. You know, recognizing that, that there's so much power in that, you know. We say that we are so ardent, so fervent, you know, going before the cross, going before Christ, and we talk about it, you know, but do we really believe it? You know, Father says, do we really live it? You know, we proclaim, but do we really live it?
Yes.
And you know, I'm thinking too that a lot of times these days, often when you put on the TV and you're hearing a lot about prosperity religion, you know, a lot of preachers are leading us, you know, do this and you will live well, and so on. You know, some others are telling us to stop suffering.
They say we shouldn't suffer because Christ suffered. That's what they say.
Yes.
We shouldn't suffer because Christ suffered.
But we're learning more and more. We're rediscovering the treasure that in that suffering, it is akin to Christ. And we go higher and higher. You know, the vertical and the horizontal.
So of course, we have the fellowship of the suffering. We have to share sufferings.
Yes.
So of course, we have the fellowship of the suffering. We are part of his sufferings, you know.
And for purification.
Yes.
You know, sometimes we need that to cut us down.
The victory is made evident out of suffering.
Yes.
Because you cannot just go straight to Resurrection Sunday.
Precisely,
you've got to go through Good Friday.
Resurrection
and that is the beauty of it.
If we follow Christ.
you're glorified out of the suffering, yes, as you give it to Christ.
Yeah, precisely.
And it's when we are weak that we are strong.
Yeah. And Paul is fantastic.
Thank you, Jesus.
I love Paul. This is Paul's words, you know.
Yes.
Paul has that sense, you know.
Yes. You know, you might be lying on that bed there, whatever, but you've pointed out to us, Father, that it's not just when ill things befall us.
Yes, no.
We're called to live it every day.
That call to deny yourself is every day.
And to go through that process, and the denial, the dying to self, to rise again.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Following.
So we must know that the denial has a purpose.
Yes.
Is that eventually we will rise, you know.
Yes.
You know, because his suffering led to resurrection.
Yes.
And it's the same word for us.
Yes.
So we have to keep our eyes on the resurrection, but don't forget Good Friday.
Yes.
You must pass through Good Friday.
one of the things, Father, that, you know, kind of touches me out of the whole thing is that we are not to look at this suffering in this kind of crestfallen, woe is me.
For me.
Me and my big toe again. I don't know what to do with this big. But really to see that as you go to the cross, the power of God comes out of that experience.
Yeah.
So it's not a matter of, well, boy, I don't know what to do again. Mm-hmm. But it's a matter of, I have
first,
the cross.
First.
I have the instrument of victory before me, and I can go to it at any time that I desire.
Yes.
We have a call, do we? Good evening.
Yes, good evening, well, Father John T. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful presentation. As usual, it reminds us that, as they say, no cross, no crown.
Yes, right,
you know, and nothing, I love your scriptures, nothing could separate us from the love of God. We always have to just hang in there, knowing that He is with us. Okay, so God bless you, Father, and thanks for the beautiful sharing.
Thank you.
You know, and you also led us again to rediscover, often we feel that we might be so unworthy that we can't approach Him. Mm-hmm. When He has it all organized already.
Of course.
You know, so whatever it is we do,
yes,
you know, or perhaps what we should have done and we didn't do,
no.
You know, you just place it before Him.
And if we are not sinners, we confuse Him.
Yeah.
He gave us sinners.
That's right.
So if you're not sinners, but he wouldn't want to know. we could feel him if you're not sinners, you know.
You
so we have to own our sinfulness and say, Lord, that's who we are.
Yes.
Own it. I say, well, no, I can look with you because you're a sinner. I came for sinners. You know?
And that self-mastery in the cross is dependent on the power of the Spirit.
Yes.
So we need to be aware of that, you know, even as we go
That's beautiful along. Language, St. Paul, with the cross and the Spirit. That's very beautiful, you know.
Yes.
Another one? Another one.
Good evening. We have another caller. Welcome.
Hello. Good evening.
Yes. Good evening.
Welcome. Good evening.
Good evening.
I want to say good night to the panel.
Sure.
Thank you.
Father Theodore, Mr. Patrick, and I think her name is Celia.
Yes.
I have listened. I have learned, and I am happy with what I listened to. I am 98 years of age. And I don't go to very early, I always wait on that program that comes on Channel 10.
Yes.
And so I am here listening to yours. Yes. Now, if you don't mind, I would like to ask Father Theodore a personal question.
Yes.
Father Theodore.
Yes.
Are you the son of the Theodores who used to own the funeral agency on Duke Street many years ago?
No. No.
No, you're not.
I'm their cousin.
Pardon me?
I am their cousin, not their son.
Oh, because they were my good friends.
Yes, that's right, yes.
So I thought they were your parents.
No. Mm-hmm.
All right, very well. Well, thank you so very, very much.
Thank you.
And I know that the nation has learned a lot from your delivery. And may God bless you all for the good
work
that you're doing and give you all health, strength, courage, endurance to continue the good work.
Thank you very much to all of you and all those of you who may have wanted to call in. So we are here exulting in the happy paradox of the cross, you know, as we seek to reap the fruits of the Spirit, you know, the fruits of the cross working in us. Just before as we leave, I want to say happy 52nd anniversary to Father Sinori, a member of your community. He's celebrating his 52nd anniversary of ordination. At Bultos Annus, Father Signore. Well, to all of you, and on behalf of Keith and Father John T, we wish you a pleasant evening, and until the next time, glory, take glory in the cross.
Bye. Jesus Christ. Amen.